It's good to hear the fellowship that's going on. But at this time, I'd like to invite everyone to prepare their hearts for worship. And as I was thinking about this, the verse from Psalms came, Psalm 139. How precious are your thoughts about me, O Lord. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of the sand. And then I awake, and you are still with me. And I thought, that's living the dream. Thank you. As you've already seen, Nelson's message is on the Word of God. That can be taken in a number of different directions. For a call to worship, I will take it more from the written Word of God. In George Foreman's book, God in My Corner, he writes, "In 1974, before I went to Africa to fight Muhammad Ali, a friend gave me a Bible for good luck. I believed the Bible was just a shepherd's handbook, probably because the only verse I knew was, 'The Lord is my shepherd.' But I was always looking for luck. I had lucky pennies, good luck charms, and now I also had a lucky Bible in my collection. After I lost the fight, I threw the Bible away. I never even opened it. I thought the Bible didn't help me win, so why do I need it? I thought I'd get power simply by owning it. I didn't realize that I needed to read and believe what it says. Since then, I've come to understand that the Bible is my roadmap, not my good luck charm." There are many comparisons that are used for the Bible. It is my compass. Another, if reading the Bible can be compared to cruising a motorboat, then studying the Bible is like slowly crossing that same lake in a glass bottom boat. The motorboat crossing provides an overview of the lake and swift passing views of its depth. The glass bottom boat of study, however, takes you beneath the surface of Scripture for an unhurried look of clarity and detail that is normally missed by those who simply read the text. As author Jerry Bridges put it, reading gives us breadth, but study gives us depth. Other comments about the Bible. While other books inform, the Bible transforms. The Bible is meant to be bread for daily use, not cake just for special occasions. Read the Bible, free gift inside. I have read many books, but the Bible reads me. The Bible is like a telescope. If you look at it, you see nothing special. But if you look through it, you see worlds beyond. Two cows were grazing in a pasture when they saw a milk truck pass by. On the side of the truck were the words, "Pasteurized, homogenized, vitamin A and D added." One cow sighed and said to the other, "Makes you feel sort of inadequate, doesn't it?" People try to improve on milk, but I'm not going there today. But one thing you will never be able to improve is the Word of God. It does not need to be any pasteurizing or homogenizing, and there's nothing that needs to be added to it. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word, your spoken word, your inspired written word, and for Jesus, the word become flesh. In your name I pray, amen.
Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, for let the ancient words impart. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart.
This time we'll ask the usher to bring the offering forward, and Marianne to have the blessing on the offering.
So good to be here this morning to see all you folks again. I never feel part of it when I'm at home because I can't see your faces and I can't talk with you, and I like to talk. Especially pick on June. And today I just got to tell you this. Today, 56 years ago, Sam and I were married. And it was a day just like this. It was beautiful. The day before, we had snow. We were kind of iffy then, but the Lord took care of the snow. But I just had to share that this morning. Thank you. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for another beautiful day. This is your day, Jesus, and thank you for it. Bless each one who has come out, and be with the ones listening at home too, Lord. Bless his offering, and we thank you for it. Bless the hands, Lord, that gave it. And Father, may it be used where needed for your honor and glory. Thank you again, Jesus, for the hope we have in you. Your blessings are new. Every morning we thank you. Great is your faithfulness. Amen. Thank you.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love. for me, all his love for me. Through the sun sets free, all is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Through the sun, I set free. All is free in me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I in my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Through the stars sets me. All is free in me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice, word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay blessed in your holiness. Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Nelson has asked me to read from the book of John, chapter 1, verses 1 and 5, 1 through 5, and also verse 14. It's John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Verse 14. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling a Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. The Lord's blessings to you, Nelson.
I like to periodically preach on what I call the doctrines of the Bible. So you have a lot of doctrines. You have the virgin birth, the death and resurrection of Christ, baptism. And this morning, we're going to take a look at the Bible as a basic doctrine. So stop and think about it a moment. I'm going to suggest, and you can challenge me at some point in this, probably not here in this setting, but without the Bible, we might not have Christianity. I don't know that. Might have been other ways that God would have sustained the church, but I'm not sure how. So it's an essential doctrine that we believe that the Bible is the Word of God, or the truth of God would be another way to say it. And for the most part, all Christian denominations would say the same thing. Now, granted, you can take two denominations and they'll say slightly different things about the Bible, or they'll interpret it slightly differently. But I'm trying to take the big picture. And the big picture is that the Bible is central to Christianity. No matter what church you attend, the Bible is going to be at some point held up as this is our standard. Now, it would be naive to think that the Bible is a totally unifying book, because we know it's not. Interpretation gets a little tricky from time to time, and so you have various denominations who highlight this and others that highlight that. And unfortunately, that sometimes creates division. But I'd like to suggest that we have a lot more in common with other Christian groups than we don't. And so we need to be careful how we relate to each other, whether it's just within the body of Christ right here, or whether it's, you know, our neighbor that goes to a different denomination or a different church. And so the Apostle Paul uses these words to challenge us on how we relate to each other from Ephesians 4:29. Do not use harmful words, but only helpful words, the kind that build up and provide what is needed, so that what you say will do good to those who hear you. I know he wasn't specifically talking about interpretation of Scripture, but he was talking about how we relate to Christians. And if we as Christians cannot relate to each other like this, what kind of testimony do we send? And so even when we disagree on some things in Scripture, it's important that we be gentle and kind and use helpful words. Now, I've always liked this acronym, so I'm sure you've probably all heard it many times. B-I-B-L-E, and some of you probably remember the song. How many remember the song? The B-I-B-L-E. Yep, a lot of you remember that. But I like this acronym. The Bible stands for Basic Instructions Before Leaving Earth. To its end is, in heaven, we don't need a Bible. We've got the truth. We've got it all. But here, we do. We need something concrete to look at, to read, to study, to hold up and say, God's word says this. And so it's the instructions that we need for life and daily living. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for gathering us here this morning, and we thank you for those who are watching online. I just pray now that you would bless my lips. The words that I speak would be the words from your Spirit. We thank you for your gospel word that speaks truth into our lives. Empower us to live it out daily. In your name we pray. Amen. Now I'm going to do a little bit of a different kind of a sermon this morning. Usually I take a text and I work through it. I'm going to take the Mennonite Confession of Faith, Article 4 and Paragraph 3. And just incidentally, at one time or another, most of you have been given this, and you probably have it hidden away on a shelf somewhere. I have a summary of the Confession of Faith, and it's 24 articles. And I laid some copies out there on the bench if you want to pick it up and take it with you. And if you want one of the full volume, 60 or 70 pages, Confession of Faith, I have several of those as well that you can have. Mennonite Church has listed 24 doctrines or articles that say, this is what we believe. And one of those is labeled Scripture. And it goes like this in paragraph 3. We accept the Bible as the Word of God written. God has spoken in many and various ways through the prophets and apostles. God has spoken above all in the living Word who became flesh and revealed the truth of God faithfully and without deception. We also acknowledge the Scripture as the fully reliable and trustworthy Word of God written in human language. We believe that God continues to speak through the living and written Word. Because Jesus Christ is the Word become flesh, Scripture as a whole has its center and fulfillment in Him. That's a mouthful. So we're going to break it down. We're going to break it into five parts. First part is we accept the Bible as the Word of God written. It's sort of what it says. We have this book that's written. It was originally written in two languages. The Old Testament was written in what language? Hebrew, and the New Testament in Greek, okay? So what we have is an interpretation or a translation into English, which went through many other versions. It went through Latin. It went through German. And so we have this Word of God written, and it's trustworthy. We'll get to that in a moment. And it's written. So it's important for us to understand that God spoke and the Word was written. Now, it's not so simple as that God spoke and moved somebody's hand, but God's Spirit told people what to write. And I like this just short little Exodus 20, verse 1. It says, and God spoke all these words. And do you know what the words were? The Ten Commandments. So that's one occasion where God literally spoke audibly, that people, Moses, heard what God spoke. And so it's important for us to understand that this is God speaking into history how many thousands of years ago, and it still holds up today, it's still valuable today, it's still worthwhile today. The second part of the Confession of Faith article says, God has spoken in many and various ways through the prophets and apostles. God has spoken above all in the living Word, and we know who that is, who became flesh and revealed the truth of God faithfully and without deception. Now, there's a lot in that one. This is the section that really digs into what the Word of God is. So first thing to remember is the Bible is made up of multiple forms of writing. If you've studied literature, you know the word is called genre. So here they are: law, history, poetry, wisdom literature, prophecy, apocalyptic literature, gospels, and epistles. So it's interesting. The Bible isn't just written like you would read a novel. It's all sort of written with the same style. Or if you read a poem, it's all written with one style. The Bible is written with multiple styles, which says to me, it's an attempt to reach everybody in every possible way. 2 Peter 3:2, Peter writes this: I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the commands given by our Lord and Savior through your apostles. So you see how this connects the old and the new? Talks about the value of what we learn from reading the prophets and then connecting that with what Jesus said and what the apostles wrote. John 1:1 adds to it by saying, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So a quick interpretation of this is, that's Jesus. Jesus is the Word. And well, guess what? He was at the beginning. He was at creation. He was with God throughout history. And He is God. And then we move on to verse 14, what the verses that Roland read. The Word became flesh. So this adds to that other passage in saying this is definitely Jesus, and made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. So the Word of God is not just written. It's not just spoken. It's also lived in the form of Jesus. And so it's so important that we have the Gospels. The Gospels are the account of Jesus' life and ministry. Without that, we would be missing so much. And so we begin to see how the Word of God is so expansive. Number three, we also acknowledge the Scripture as the fully reliable and trustworthy Word of God written in human language. It's a paradox. Human language is frail. We have trouble sometimes. You ever do this? You're trying to tell somebody something and you just can't quite get the right words out. So human language doesn't always do what it needs to do. But when the language is spoken through the power of the Holy Spirit into the Word of God, it is fully reliable and trustworthy. I love that. We can take this Bible and we can read it and we can know that what it says is reliable and trustworthy, even though it's written in human language. The Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy these words in 2 Timothy 3. He said, all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that all God's people may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. It's telling us what the Bible does for us. It equips us. It prepares us to live the Christian life. And I love that phrase, God breathed. So I know, for example, as Paul was writing, he had this sense that the Spirit was moving. It was God breathing into the words as he wrote those words. Number four, we believe that God continues to speak through the living and written Word. Every Christian I know has experienced this at one time or another. You're reading the Scripture, and you might have read it 6 times before or 100 times before, and suddenly like that, something new jumps out at you. It happens to me on a regular basis. God continues to speak through the living and written word. It's written, but it's not just words on a page. It becomes alive when it touches us and speaks into our hearts. And we discover new things each and every day. The writer of Hebrews adds to that. He says, "For the word of God is alive and active." I love this phrase. "Sharper than any double-edged sword, it penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart." I think all of us can say amen to that. That we've experienced that. Sometimes you don't like that it's sharper than a double-edged sword. It's like, oh man, I didn't need to hear that. But then we realize it's so important because that's what changes the way we live. We read it, it penetrates, it's active and alive. And then the fifth section of the confession of faith on the scripture says, "Because Jesus is the Word become flesh, scripture as a whole has its center and fulfillment in Him." Most of you have heard me say this before. The Bible is not a flat book. And what I mean by that is you need to interpret the Old Testament by the New Testament. As Christians, the New Testament is the foundation for our beliefs. And so when we read the Old Testament, we read it in light of what Jesus did, in light of what Paul and Peter wrote. We always interpret back from the New Testament to the Old Testament. And Jesus refers to this when he says in Matthew 5:17, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." And then you know what, because we went through the Sermon on the Mount, there's this whole series of, "It was said, but I say." In other words, Jesus is interpreting the Old Testament in light of his coming. And again, Jesus adds this in Luke 16:16. "Until John the Baptist, the law of Moses and the messages of the prophets were your guides. But now the good news of the kingdom of God is preached, and everyone is eager to get in." I love that. Once we hear this word of God, once we acknowledge who Jesus is, that he is the active word of God, he is the way, the life, and the truth, we realize how important it is for us to accept him and to follow him. Luke, when he wrote to the book of Acts, says it this way: "Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name given under heaven by which we must be saved." Jesus is the cornerstone. He's the foundation. So yes, the Bible is a key doctrine, but it's because it points to Jesus. So the essence of our salvation is committing our lives to Christ. The application this morning, I'm going to use 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 to 21. One of the things that makes the Bible so significant is that much of it is written by eyewitnesses, especially the New Testament, the Gospels and the Epistles. That adds credibility to this Word of God, to this truth. 2 Peter 1, starting at verse 16. "For we did not," and he's talking about the apostles, "follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in power, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty." In other words, Peter is saying, we didn't make this up. We saw it. We walked with him. We ministered with him for 3 years, and we know exactly what he taught and why he was here and what his death and resurrection mean. So eyewitnesses are crucial to the value of the Word of God. 17 and 18. He received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory saying, "This is my Son whom I love, with him I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain. Does anybody know the big word that's used to describe that event? Transfiguration. You guys are good. Remember that? Jesus took some of the disciples up on a mountain and he encountered the Father. And Peter was one of those. And he heard the voice, and I always love this little piece of the story. And then Peter wanted to build some tents and some buildings to preserve this occasion. Strikes me as something that most of us would want to do. But the key to the story is that Peter heard this audible voice. He's an eye and ear witness, and he's passed this on to us. Again, he gives it integrity. Verse 19. We also have the prophetic message as something completely reliable, and you will do well to pay attention to it, as to a light shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. So Peter wants us to know that the Old Testament is valuable. Reading the prophets is valuable. It gives us light. I like that. Until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. We've experienced some of that as we read Scripture. There's things that just warm our hearts. Verse 20 goes on. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. It's the power of the Spirit. It's the Spirit moving and working in the prophets. And so when you go back and you read the prophets and you just are speaking God's word, for prophecy never had its origin in the human will. But prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. I love that. I personally at times have experienced just a tiny piece of that. I might be working on a sermon or I might be having a devotional, and there's sort of like a light bulb comes on. There's something that seems to happen. A sense of the Holy Spirit speaking into some situation that I'm experiencing right now. And that's what Peter is saying, that prophecy is not something that comes from human will. Even though we're human, God's Spirit moves and speaks into our lives. I hope we understand that the Bible is absolutely essential to the life of a Christian. I would refer to it as our lifeblood. If you're not spending time in God's Word, I would imagine you're dying spiritually. Without it, we would have very little to go on. How would we know what to believe? Let's be grateful for this Word of God. Thank God for it every day. And for all that it teaches us, it is the living and active Word of God. It speaks to our hearts comfort, encouragement, challenge. It brings us closer to God. And this is the interesting thing about the Bible. As old as it is, it speaks to every experience that we have in one way or another. It is always relevant. It is never out of touch. It's a book that brings newness every time you read it. I don't know that there's any other books ever written that have that same quality to it. 1 Peter 1, 23 to 25 is important for us to hear. Peter writes, "For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring Word of God. That's how we discovered who Christ is. For all people are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the Word of God endures forever. And this is the word that was preached to you. Our rebirth, our salvation comes as we discover God through His Word, because it is reliable and trustworthy. Let's pray. Lord, we can't thank you enough for this Bible, this scripture, this Word of God that's reliable and trustworthy, that speaks into our lives and touches us. We offer ourselves to you because of what we read in this book. And we ask you to continue to reveal yourself to us as we read and study your word. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Now is our time for sharing your prayer requests, your praises. How is God working in your life in the past week or so? Anyone have anything they want to share?
Hi, this is Marianne. Saruman at Home Auxiliary wants to thank you people that have given for the Rockathon. We collected $430, so I want to thank you very much.
Thank you, Marianne.
This is June Shenk. This week, Diane reminded me to go on the website and watch the bald eagles out near Hanover, Pennsylvania. There's a live webcam there, and you can watch this bald eagle in the nest with its baby and one egg to be hatched yet. But this week, as I was watching it, watching this huge bird feed its baby chick, it reminded me somehow we see of God as this huge being, sometimes fierce. This bald eagle to me looks so fierce with its eyes and its huge pointy beak. Food from a fish or whatever else it was there and put it in the mouth of this tiny baby chick. And it was just reminded me that, yes, God can sometimes feel big and fierce and huge and out there, but he takes care of us. He loves us. And he takes time to feed us and to watch over us. And that was a good reminder for me.
Thank you, June. Anyone else? Not seeing anyone, let's pray. Lord, thank you for your many blessings to us. Thank you for being our all-powerful God. Thank you for the illustration that June gave, that you are like the big, fierce eagle, but yet you care for your young. Protect them and provide for them. Thank you for the generosity of those that gave to the Rockathon. And Lord, I pray a blessing on that gift, that it would be used in your kingdom. I ask all these things in your name. Amen. Any announcements that anyone would have right now?
The sheet for the children's stories during the service is out in the lobby. Thanks, June, for signing up for one Sunday in April. There's lots more for you to have your chance. Thanks.
From the trustees, due to COVID and other reasons, we have lost more than several men that have been doing the lawn mowing here. Right now, actively, because we kind of started over with having so many drop out. So we have three men that are willing to mow the lawn. If you are interested and want to continue, please call me, email me, text me. Just let me know so I can get you on the list. We'll probably be mowing by Easter. So give me a call and let me know if you'd like to be on the list for the mowing.
Thank you, Jim. Anyone else? If not, at this point, I'll turn it back to Nelson.
To you, my friends at Boyertown Mennonite Church, I write this. In July, it will be 26 years that I have been pastor at Boyertown Mennonite Church. It is the only church I've had the privilege of pastoring, and it has been a great experience with wonderful people. However, all good things must come to an end, so I am officially announcing my retirement for January 31, 2022. I will turn 70 in February 2022 and feel it is time to move into a different stage of life. I look forward to joining my wife, June, in her retirement. I must confess that it has looked good on her and trust that I will also enjoy it. I know the commitments that you have all made to this church, and I know that I will leave it in good hands. God has been faithful to this congregation for 241 years, and I know that Christ Church will continue to minister to this community through God's Spirit. The leadership team and church council will take the lead, along with our Mosaic Mennonite Conference leadership minister, Noel Santiago, in the process of moving forward. I wish you all the best and trust that these final 10 months can be productive as we look forward to what God has in store for each of us. I hope you know that I believe in you and know that the work of Christ will continue. May the Lord's blessing leadership for the next stage of ministry here.
Just a brief word of background here. After today's service, both the letter that was just read by Pastor Nelson and the letter that I will read for Church Council's response will be mailed out to the members of the congregation. Those who are here today, Roland will have a copy. Please pick one up on your way out. So with that in mind, the document I have here is Church Council's and the leadership team's response. And it goes like this: Greetings, Boyertown Mennonite Church congregation. With mixed emotions, Church Council received and accepted the letter of retirement from Pastor Nelson Shenk at the most recent meeting of Church Council on March 17th, 2021. Nelson will retire as pastor on January 31st, 2022. Nelson will be greatly missed. He's been a faithful teacher, mentor, friend, and fellow servant of Christ over his 26 years as pastor at Boyertown Mennonite Church. Pastor Nelson has shared his passion for Christ, his gifts of service and leadership, and his struggles and concerns. But above all, he has continued to walk with us on the journey to grow in the Word. And he will be missed dearly. At the same time, This is certainly a well-earned retirement. We as a church are glad for Nelson after the next 10 months, of course, as he begins to enjoy his retirement with June, has more time for his children and grandchildren and his hobbies, plus continues to be a beacon to Christ in all the lives he touches. There will be much work for all of us in the coming months and the year ahead. Pastor Nelson has already begun working to ensure that everything is in place for the next person. The leadership team with Church Council will be walking through a transition plan tailored to our situation based on the guidance provided by the Mosaic Conference. We will keep you informed of our progress along the way. We are calling the congregation to prayer. We believe God is already preparing the next person for us, and we as a congregation are being prepared for that person as well. We ask for continued prayer for Pastor Nelson as he continues to lead us in Christ until his retirement, and for the leadership team and every member of this congregation as we begin the work of transitioning to the future that God has in store for Boyertown Mennonite Church. If you have any questions, please do not hesitate to talk to any of the Church Council members. Signed, your brothers and sisters in Christ, Church Council. There's a few verses I'd like to read from 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 to 19. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. This is a time of transition. And I'd like to ask for a moment of prayer, if Pastor Nelson would come down. Father God, we pray for Pastor Nelson. We pray for our congregation. We praise you for all that you have in store for us and for all the blessings that you have given us through Pastor Nelson over the past 26 years. Please guide our steps, guide Pastor Nelson's steps in his life. Please bring us closer to you. Help us to lean into you, for you have plans for us. Help us to see them, work towards them, and find our next steps during this time of uncertainty. And above all, we lift these concerns up to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way. Still, you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed. I will not forget your love for me and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide, hold me to your side. I will love you to the end.
I invite you to stand with me for the benediction. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ has set you free from the law of sin and of death. Amen. You may go in peace.